here with the Premier and perhaps more importantly for this discussion, Minister of Sustainability and Climate Resiliency, Mr. Wayne Panton. So we just wanted to ask, we've been focusing very heavily on sustainability, climate resiliency in the newspaper over the past month or two. That's your area.
Yes.
How concerned are you about these latest UN reports, the IPCC reports that last one talked about an atlas of suffering and what that looks like for Cayman potentially being on the front lines of the impacts here?
Right. Well, obviously, it is a significant concern. This is, this underscores the reason that I have created this specific Ministry of Sustainability and Climate Resiliency. Because I have understood for a long time that there are significant consequences that the country and the people of the country will endure with significant climate change if we don't be a part of the solution to helping to mitigate or reduce those impacts, and if we don't build in place mechanisms to give us the resiliency against those impacts. It is, sometimes it's of concern to me that we have to talk about these matters that are, that really reflect an existential threat to our, not just to our quality of life, but potentially our existence. But we have to face the reality and we have to do something about it. And I believe, and I'm very optimistic, that we can take the necessary steps to address these issues and to mitigate significantly some of the impacts that that these predicted changes will bring. One of the major things, obviously, is sea level rise for Cayman. We are, particularly Grand Cayman and Little Cayman, low-lying islands. Many of the residential areas are in the sort of average or below average height above sea level areas. So you've done some articles recently, and they do reflect and indicate that a sea level rise, which is within the predicted ranges, would have a significant impact. I think we need to make sure that we do two things. One is we do everything we can to contribute to minimizing the climate change impact. And then secondly, do what we must do to build in the resiliency to those impacts. Hopefully those impacts are going to be less than predicted, because we have been a part of not just doing our part, but we've been strong advocates for ourselves and other small island states like ourselves that are going to be impacted if the world doesn't get on board with the commitments that have been made at COP25 through the Paris Accord and more recently last year at COP26.
Mm-hmm.
There is an understanding of what we need to do. There just needs to be a collective will and a commitment to taking those actions.
And you have a climate risk analysis in the works, you have a development plan in the works, and I think people...
Yes.
Those are the two areas probably very interconnected where we can build in some resiliency. And, are we going to get... I mean, I hate to put it this way, but are we going to get tough with the developers? Are we going to, be able to tell people no when it's not what... Cayman needs for the next 34 years?
Well, what I hope we can do is get to a point where there is clarity that we shouldn't have to tell someone no. They should understand that things have to be done differently. They can't be done this way. Mm-hmm. It has to be done in a different way to get a better outcome, a different outcome. So do we have to get tough? I think we all have to accept that we all have to do things differently. It shouldn't just be up to the government to say that. But if it's necessary for the government to do it, then I think we need to be prepared to do that. We need to be prepared to be leading on these issues, setting examples, taking responsibility where we need to. At the end of the day, it's our responsibility to make sure that, you know, that the people of our country have a good quality of life, have the safety that they want, have the ability for their children to have a future. And to me, that is one of the most compelling things. You cannot tell anybody in the country that their children children are not going to have a similar or better quality of life than they had, and they'll find that acceptable. Everybody wants their children to have a strong, sound future with prospects that are similar to theirs. And I fundamentally believe that this generation and the generations around us and before us do not have the right to continue to pursue prosperity if it is at the cost of the prosperity of the children in the future.
So give me the optimistic answer then to finish on. What does Cayman look like in 2050? Because we did some maps that showed the parts could be underwater almost, but I mean, that's extreme scenario, but yeah. What does Cayman look like in 2050 if we get everything right as a government and as a private sector?
I think if we get everything right, to me that, I'm going to say that includes not just Cayman, but that includes the world, the geopolitical system that recognizes as governments, as private entities, that we've all got to come together to address climate change, and that we do limit the impacts to, the increases in average temperature to 1.5 degrees centigrade or less. We believe, and I think the current collective view is that if we can do that, then the impacts are more manageable. And I believe that puts us in a position in terms of Cayman, and I believe if we work together, we can achieve this, where the impacts are going to be obvious, but they're going to be much more manageable. The impacts on our quality of life will have been mitigated or addressed completely, and there's not going to be a lot of change in terms of quality of life for Caymanians. But that isn't going to happen unless we make it happen. So I think that is what we as a government, that is how I feel as the Premier, and I think that's what we need to achieve for the country and the world.